Very special thanks to Philip Raby Specialist Cars, of course, for providing the vehicle in this video, and of course those who are familiar with the Beards and Cars series will know that if you'd like to check out their website, see what their current stock is, maybe even look further into a particular vehicle, even one that's already sold, then of course you can click the link right below this video in the description and check out what they've currently got. For this particular episode of Beards and Cars, it's gonna actually be a little bit special to me, because funnily enough, this is not a car which I went to Philip Raby with the intention of driving. In fact, the previous two cars in this series, the Aston Martin DB7 and the Jag XKRS, are actually the reason why I went to visit him. While I was there though, Philip kindly suggested that I give this car a look as well, because in a kind of time capsule way, this is a vehicle with a lovely little story to its name, and it's something totally different to what I would usually look at. And as such, of course, I'm approaching making this video in a different way than I usually would. In fact, honestly, I've never felt so much like Jay Leno's garage as I do right now, because of course we're not going to be getting into the usual 0-60 times and used values and common problems and what it's like to live with such and such vehicle, because this just doesn't fall into those kind of parameters. This is just an episode to take a look at a really fascinating little classic. Now, one of the most interesting things about this car is the condition it's in, and the love which has been given to it, because despite being from 1973, as you'll have noticed from the thumbnail of the video, it's covered less than 19,000 miles. And in fact, of those 19,000 miles, about 18,000 of them were pre the year 2000. So since then, it's done even less. Now, I'm not going to get into every single sentence and every single paragraph of this car's documented history, but suffice it to say that for anyone who is interested in buying it, the last owner of the four people who have owned this vehicle put in a lot of effort, a huge amount of effort, in fact, tracking down this car's history and putting it all to paper. A lovely little story in its own right, and I'm going to feature some of the highlights herein. Now, for those who are unfamiliar, or at least less familiar with the Cortina, this, as I said, is a 1973 model, and that means that this is a Mark III Series 2 car. In particular, though, it's the rarer version called the L Decor. Now, the Decor is kind of like a specialized trim option for the Cortina, and it has a number of small details here and there which make it the quote-unquote upmarket version to go for, and these were actually only built between August of 1973 and 74, so even its production run wasn't all that long. Now, of those, even less of them are the two-door, and even less of them are the automatic version, as this one is. So, according to the research that has been done, there is at least a possibility that this might be the only car of its type in the UK, in that exact spec. Could be wrong, but that seems to be the case according to the Cortina forums, etc., and owner's registry, which those previous owners did research into. Now, the engine in this one is one of two which you could find in the L Decor models, either a 1.3 or a 1.6, or as they would have called it back then, a 1300 or a 1600. This one is the larger of the two. So, you know, for a smaller Cortina of its time, it's a decent sized engine, 1.6 engine with an automatic gearbox. So how does it actually feel? First of all, because a 1973 gearbox, Ford or otherwise, could feel absolutely horrendous. Even in a European spec Ford, it's not exactly the era where automatics were known for being their best. Well, actually, it's a lovely little automatic. Now, it has a little bit of a judder here and there, especially when you first start it up, for example. You need to let it idle and warm up for a little bit, and crucially, when you switch between drive and reverse when you've come to a stop, for example, to maneuver through a car park. Under those circumstances, you can feel its age a little bit, but while driving, it's actually pretty smooth, and it's a surprisingly quick little car. This is the kind of vehicle that you'd describe as nippy. It's that kind of performance. It's not going to break any records, but it can get up to 65, 70 miles an hour, no problem. And the handling, although with a drastic difference to today's power steering, was charming, I'll say, to work with. It's certainly very different to anything else I've driven in the series so far, and to show my younger age, and to just lay my cards on the table, this is by far the oldest vehicle I've ever driven. And in fact, funnily enough, the second oldest vehicle I've driven was the first car I ever drove, my dad's 1982 Vauxhall Cavalier, which was also a 1600. The oldest car before this to be featured in Beards and Cars, though, was from 1990, and that was the Rolls-Royce Silver Shadow. So that, of course, feels classic, because Rolls-Royce models kind of harken back to older decades, even in their newer form. This one, though, is full-on classic. Not just the 70s, but early 70s, super rare spec with that really in-your-face Daytona yellow paint. Now, for those who do have the keen eye for the Cortina aficionado, you might notice something that seems to be missing for an L Decor on this car. Because, to list some of those differences that set the L Decor model, that trim level, apart, that included loop pile carpets, how extravagant, grab handles on the doors, a vanity mirror, the glove box had some illumination, it had a cigarette lighter, a 3-speed heater fan for the interior, steady on now, a vinyl roof, and some side stripes on the body. And that, of course, is what's missing, and the reason for that is because in the 80s, the original yellow paint had actually faded a little bit too much for the owner's liking at the time. Now, this car's first owner had it for 13 years, and then the second owner had it for 20 years. So, certainly a beloved car in that sense. It was resprayed, of course, as you can see, yellow again, in 1988, but for whatever reason, those side stripes were not replaced. You could view that as slightly unfortunate, according to the car's original spec, but again, it's not something that you couldn't remedy if you so chose anyway. Now, for those with, once again, a keen eye for the Cortina, you will notice one or two other things which don't seem quite right to that original car, and this really will be for the keen eye, because there are three things in particular which are different compared to that original stock vehicle, but they're pretty subtle, and I would say they're appropriate to the vehicle. The first one is the speakers inside on the doors. The second is that it has a windscreen wash button, which is not original, and of course most notably the aftermarket sunroof, which is a period correct pop-up style sunroof. Again, it suits the car, and I would have never guessed honestly that it wasn't an original thing, because as I kind of alluded to, or have at least hinted at, I'm certainly not a Cortina aficionado myself. Perhaps the most fascinating thing about this car's backstory, though, because as is often the case, a car that is so much older, that's been cherished so much, and has had owners who have kept it for a long time, is that a car will develop stories. And the most notable one for this vehicle is that it almost became a TV famous hero car. In fact, the people behind the BBC series Life on Mars intended for this to be the primary car in the series. They even bought it off of its owner at the time through eBay to use it as such. But when they came to look at the car, unfortunately, and I thought it was only me who had luck like this, but apparently other people do as well, the cam belt broke. And that was just enough to put the producers off. Unfortunately, because this car would have been the star of the series. That didn't happen, of course they moved on, and this ended up being still a gorgeous little time capsule, but one which almost had stardom, and in some ways not quite reaching stardom, is kind of an even better story now, in hindsight, although I'm sure the owner at the time didn't feel that way. Now, of course, I can't just go through this video without even touching on how this does compare to my usual expectations of cars, and of course, comparing it to most of the vehicles which I've driven. Now, I'm not going to do anything ridiculous like saying, well, it doesn't feel as good as a modern car, or it's not quite as responsive, or the handling's a little too heavy. Well, of course it is. Just because I haven't driven too many classics doesn't mean I'm not a fan of them, and of course, being a mechanic myself, I'm all too familiar with the differences in era between modern and classic technology. In some ways, I actually find it superior. If you were to, for example, work with minimal tools on two vehicles, either a brand new vehicle from whatever brand from today, or a classic 70s or 80s car, well, I promise you, you can do a whole lot more with a classic with some bubble gum and a hammer than you can with a car today. Now, the way this car feels is of course totally different to a modern car, that goes without saying. I did find that in some ways it was surprisingly fun by today's standards, because is it fast? Well, yes and no. For its time, pretty quick, as I alluded to, it's nippy, but it's not fast per se. The handling, although not a particularly large car, certainly isn't going to win an autocross event anytime soon. and the brakes of course show their age, they're not the most powerful around. But even so, for its time, for a car that hasn't been, you know, retrofitted or modified to be some little hot rod, it actually does perform pretty well. It holds up surprisingly well. It actually doesn't wallow around through corners anywhere near as much as I would have expected. For example, compared to that 1990 Rolls-Royce, as comfortable as it was, this actually feels much sportier. And of course, that's an obvious statement to make yet again, but for a car that's that much older, to actually feel a little bit tighter and sharper and sportier, to me that's still impressive, because there are certainly cars of this level which tried to be sporty that didn't achieve that, from various countries around the world at the time, both older and newer. So to me, it was actually quite a refreshing experience to get into a car and drive a car which I could very easily have seen my old man driving. My old man was a Cavalier guy. He loved the Vauxhall Cavalier in multiple forms, and he loved classics. He would often go for one if he could find one, although more often than not his budget didn't allow for anything extravagant. At the same time, as soon as I opened the door on this car, the smell, and I'm not exactly sure what the smell is, it may be the plastic or how they treated the seats or something like that, was immediately familiar. It smelled just like certain classics which my old man had. And it's interesting just how much of a time warp it can feel just to sit in a car like this. It's almost like if you own a car from this era, of this age, even if you don't use it that much, it kind of feels like sitting in a museum piece, except it's yours. And that is such a wonderful feeling. I mean, I don't own a classic, but I can just imagine how happy that would make you, wherein you don't need to buy a ticket and walk around, for example, the Haynes Museum and look at these classic cars that are worth so much. You can open your garage door, sit in something that smells and sounds like a literal time warp to 40 or 50 years ago in some cases, if not more, and feel like you've just jumped back in time. And I tell you what, even a car which at the time people would have derided, even today, you know, people make jokes out of cars like Yugos and Ladas, etc. But if you drive down the street in something like this, Cortina or otherwise, you know, any classic really, and especially a vintage car that's even older, it puts a smile on people's faces. If you drive past in a Ferrari or a Porsche 911, people might look at it, people might smile. If you drive past in a classic or a vintage car, everyone looks at it, because there's something almost intangible to me about a classic wherein it could be worth 10 times more than a Ferrari. But at the same time, nobody will find you to be an insufferable you-know-what for owning it. People just appreciate classics. There's just that intangible charm to an older car, especially one which has the history and the love and the care which one like this has had. Is it immaculate? No. But it's pretty close to it, and it's in better condition than some of the cars that I've owned, which are more like a decade or two old. So I would actually say it was a lovely experience to get to drive something like this. I would love to drive more classics on the channel, but I just don't get as much opportunity to do so. And of course, for the average viewer, especially with the kinds of review that I typically do, it's just not as applicable for many people. I personally think that this video probably won't get quite as many views as something like a Jag XKR or a Porsche 911, but for those who do watch it, I hope you've enjoyed it. It's a totally different kind of video, as I said, a stroll down memory lane, and I hope for those of you who grew up around these here in the UK or elsewhere, I hope this has given you some good memories of thinking back to those times and of seeing a charming car like this in action again. But overall, that's it for this video. Of course, stick around on the channel for more cars, both classic and modern, most of which, to be honest, will be modern, but hopefully the occasional classic like this again. And until next time, I'll see you then. But for now, as always, thanks for watching.